Thank you, everyone. So, how many of you are working in an environment that actually feels that it could use some change? Yeah? Yes. There's quite a few industries out there that are yearning for change. And what do you do when you know that there's change that needs to be done, but no one wants to take the leap for change? You as a younger or energetic, passionate person that comes into the environment and see all these problems, where do you start? Where do you begin to combine all the different problems and find a way to start working on change? And how do you convince the people around you to do that as well, to follow you? So this story is about that. About 2010, I've had this incredible passion for interior design and architecture. And I had a background in computer science. I know how to code, but I was longing for the sense of belonging. And this, a lot of people would understand this if you've been to a different country and you look different or you speak differently. My logical conclusion was I should go and study the art and science of what makes a home. And that happens to be interior design. So, okay, I'm gonna go study interior design. And the moment that I step into the school and I start talking to the people, and I realize, wow, they have not changed since 15 years ago. The way they do business, the way they do drawing, the way they communicate, the tools that they use are old as hell. Now, I was at a crossroad. I've invested so much money, I've invested so much time, and people are depending on me to get a degree. What do I do? I'm literally looking down on my feet and seeing this industry not going anywhere. At the time, I thought that it was going nowhere. I thought, okay, when you have a problem and you don't know what to do to solve it, what do you do? Well, at the time, I wrote it down. I wrote down all the things that was wrong about it. And if you're going through the same similar things, you should write down everything as well. The wrong things about it, the good things about it, write it down and analyze it. Now you have a place to start, because this feeling now has a place to begin. It's reality now. Dump. What does this do? All right. There we go. So I went into intern for architecture firms. Most of the leaders in those firms do things the old way. It was great. It was an artistry. It was artistry as in, like, it was art. You should respect the art. It's supposed to be mysterious. It's supposed to be insufficient and inefficient and beautiful. Somehow, some way, it comes out beautiful. But the problem with this is that people are not communicating. As a result, there's a lot of either non-communication or miscommunication. As a result, there's a lot of waste, because there's a waste in time, there's a waste of money, there's a waste of valuable passion from people. And being a young kid, knowing what I know what to do is like, there should be a way to do things more efficiently. There should be a way to combine artistry with technology, like this 3D printed, actually, this is a 3D carved vase. So what I set out to do is, not only did I write things down, I also started to research what other industries have gone through this life cycle. They've gone through the analog to digital transition. They've gone through the dying and reborn transition. So a few industries, one is the publication industry, the other one is the retail industry, and the last one I thought was most significant is the music industry. Nowadays, we all know that these have a different format, and it's a lot faster, it's a lot more trackable. It's also, surprisingly, did not, I mean, a lot of people lost their jobs, but then a lot more jobs was created. So what do we do? What do we do with this outdated architectural and interior design industry? My name is Polley Wong. I come from New York. I have an interior design and architecture firm, and I also have a tech firm that is trying to solve the problem of this seemingly ginormous, hard to solve, but really important problem. Our industry is about 30% of the global GDP. Why? Because almost everyone in every country, their largest investment in their life is most likely a home. And what do they have to do with that home? It's so personal, it's so passionate that they just want to make it perfect. And we have such an opportunity to come into people's lives, to make a change, to love them the way they want to be loved in a very technical and engineering sense, that we have lost this ability and lost this drive to learn new things. So I come in and I thought, okay, these are the problems. Are they really the problems that need to be solved? I was young, I was a student. How do I know? I mean, these are the problems that I feel. How do I know that those are really the problem? I had to go in. I had to go dig deep into the industry and truly learn, truly feel the pain. Why do I have to feel the pain? Why is pain important in change? Because the biggest obstacle of change is fear. And the best weapon against fear is fearing the other side, fearing the result of not changing. You have to feel the pain in order to sustain the difficult task of changing the industry. Since it is a multi-billion dollar industry, and whatever industry that you're in, if you do want to create change, you really need to know what the true problem is. And it usually comes down to one or two important things. And these one or two important things are not usually not technical. They're usually extremely human-centered and human-oriented. In our case, our main pain point was communication. The lack of communication, the inaccuracy of communication, the not enough frequent of communication, and also communicating the wrong things. I think that was also a problem in our industry. The other thing that you need to know about pain is that the costliest mistake in either creating a new product or creating a new company or creating a new career or creating a new industry is that you think that is what you want or that is needed, except you build something and that's not needed. And in software engineer, you have all sorts of different technologies that prevent this, such as rapid prototyping, extreme programming, all these different ways of, and even revision control is to control, to manage people's needs and what you're building matches up. So, and hopefully you're doing it in an efficient way. But this is why you need to get to pain, because pain is usually very close to the truth, and truth is usually very painful. And this is just something in nature. So you want to be in it, but not into it. You cannot change an industry if you're coming from the outside. And this is a message to all the technology companies out there, is that they come in with a lot of technology, which is great, but they are not in it. They are coming from the outside and trying to inject a new product to you. So if you are, you happen to be in an older industry or an industry that needs evolution and revolution, then it is important for you to know that you being in the industry is of value. Do not think that those bigger companies, the tech companies, yes, they have money, yes, they have resources, but you're in it. You know the problem, you know the customer, you know your people, the companies within it. So the second thing is you need to find the common denominator. Denominator is 公分母. So you need to find that one thing that combines all of those problems that you've written down. And it's usually, as I said, one or two things. And in our case, it was miscommunication. The second thing was waste. I also mentioned that. The third thing is inaccessibility. And that was a combination of, it was mostly because of miscommunication. But inaccessibility is a common thing in, I think, mostly top-down, top-heavy industry. Yes. So when the people in the top are controlling all the information, then there's bound to be miscommunication because they're not releasing it. And this is why open design and open source is so important, which we will get to later, that this is the problem that we're trying to solve. So while you're doing this, you have to think, okay, I gotta solve this. I gotta solve this in a sustainable manner and hopefully in a connecting manner. Because just like starting a company, if you don't sustain yourself, you're gonna die. You're gonna lose your job. And in order to solve that, actually connection is the key, which we will get to later. I think this was a conclusion that I came to after, I would say, about 6 years of starting a company, that if you want to sustain your learning process and experimenting process within changing a career, then you need to be connected. There is no other way that you will be able to do it on your own. And most likely, people on the top that are already representing the industry and not willing to change, they won't be helping you. So you need your peers, you need to help the later generations to be part of your crew, be part of your vision. The third thing, was it the third thing or the second thing? Something, is time. You need to have a different sense of time. Technology has changed the definition of time, whether you like it or not. Every second you absorb a totally different amount of information comparing to someone from 10 years ago. And sometimes you could do so much, I would say so much more in such a shorter time, but sometimes you could spend a lot more time in something much more detailed and that is of interest of you. So you have to change your understanding of time. And while you're doing making changes, time really is life. And when I say this, it's because our company has truly experienced when we don't pay attention to time while we're implementing change, it usually results in either the company goes very, very close to dying, or we get far away from what the customer or what the client or what the industry really wants. So you have to understand that now that I'm aware and sensible with time, everything changes. And other people's sense of time will change as well. Now, who is the best teacher of change? Who would you say? Everyone knows. That's right, I heard it. Nature. That's right. Nature is the best teacher of change. How do she implement change? How does she not change? It never not changes. That's the question. So if you think about it, if nature is always changing and always sustaining life and always sustaining the change in itself, what makes the change, what can I learn from it? I think the key word is balance here. Change cannot happen sustainably without balance. What that means is that you have to understand that there is no one force that would steer you in the right direction. Just like driving a car, you are driving with a lot of micro actions and a lot of attention to a lot of places. You're not doing one thing one time and like focus and not changing. So you understanding that changing is a micro action that creates balance, and these micro actions happen all over the place and not just one person. And sometimes you feel that the force is good, sometimes you feel the force is bad, but they all contribute to a good change if you're aware. When you run a company more like an ecosystem, it really is about the cycle and not the goal. It's easy to say, but the way we did it, the way our company figured out how to create sustainability is by creating two companies. One company does design work, that we get deeper and deeper into the problem and understanding the people within the ecosystem and how they interact and why, how far is the problem affecting. And then the second company is looking far and wide, creating a technical solution and also trying not to be too precise because we're also learning. We don't know the real answer to that. You know, what does the new industry look like? We don't know. Another thing that is also contributing to the balance is that the design company have a very short iteration of business model, meaning that every project comes in and out roughly between 2 weeks to a year. So if my project could end within a month, that means I could get paid in a month. What that means is that your other company that is trying to create change has a higher chance to be independent. Because everyone knows if you're in open source or open source community that when you have money in it, a lot of things changes. You don't get the freedom of experimenting. You don't get you can't get to the truth that easily because now you have to use that tool to survive. While if you have a different company that is providing your livelihood, then it'll be able to, you know, one company supports the other. And that was hard, but that was the balance that I'm talking about, that you have to look at the near sight and the far sight. You have to look at far sight as strategy, 大方向, or you could look at the near sight tactics, How do I survive the next day? How do I survive the next month so that I could be free of outside investments to sustain the important change that is for the next 5 to 10 years? Separating the tactics and strategy is very, very important. The fourth thing is design thinking. I think this has been a buzzword for a long time. The reason why I think is very important is because you can't really create, we just mentioned time is different now. So if you want to iterate change and change fast and mostly correct, you have to really quickly rapid prototype everything, including your business, including how you deal with your own companies, your own challenges. For example, we try to, the biggest risk of creating a software is creating the wrong software, I just mentioned. So our design company we attract customers that could be our software's guinea pig. They are testing our product for us. That way we could have an immediate feedback loop to be able to actually test faster and cheaper. And the other way around is our customers actually think, design customers think that, oh, you're going high tech and all this. So that actually helps us sell to create more customers. Wait, yes. So an ecosystem is an ecosystem. You have to, and this will bring us to the next point, is that when you're dealing with changing within the whole industry, you're usually not talking about one job. You're not talking, like in our case, you're not talking about just designers. You're talking about contractors, you're talking about homeowners, you're talking about project managers. All these people are within themselves their own professionals. If you only think about yourself, the industry will not change because the problem, part of the problem, is communication. And communication is not just horizontally, but vertically. So when you are thinking about, say you want to revamp education system, or you want to revamp financial systems, you have to think about all the other players within this whole ecosystem. And excuse me, if you do, usually they will agree that yes, there is a problem, because the cross industry people, like Chinese you would call it 窗口, they are the people that suffer the most usually when they need to upgrade. So the last point I want to bring is balance is key, and everything. Think of change less as task change. Think of change more like an energy that basically when you say 能量守恒, when you say I don't even know how to say 能量守恒 in English, but in any case, what comes around goes around. When you push a certain type of change, the other side of the people will fight the change, and then you're gonna have to like maneuver and create more changes so that those forces could balance themselves out. The last point I want to bring is that you have to include people. And it's not only about open source, but open source is very important. It's not only about being open-minded, but open-minded is extremely important. And it's not only about open design, but open design is, you can't do it without that. So in order to sustain your change, you have to connect. Say you, for example, if you are in business, if you're in the industry, it would be highly beneficial if you connect with people in the education system, meaning that they're training new people in, you want to get in and start, say, creating workshops, creating teaching sessions, or just talks Why? Because those people have not been set on, in stone yet. Those kids are still learning, they're absorbing and observing. And you want to connect to that. Also, you want to connect to the people that are up high, but also open-minded. You have to do it well-rounded in order to sustain yourself being part of the change, and hopefully lead the change. And the last thing to understand is learning how to learn is how you're gonna survive, because we don't know how things are gonna change. We want to initiate change, but we are also affected by change. And change is what it is that you don't know what it is. You don't know where it's gonna go, and that's risk. And that's why people fight it. But if you know how to learn, you could deal with anything. It doesn't matter where the force pushes you. And therefore, agility is a muscle that you have to practice. If you're in a place that is somewhat stale and stagnant and stable, then you have to find other exercises, mind exercises, coding exercises, design exercises to keep your brain, agile. Keep your creativity agile. And if you could, recently I've spoke with a leader, and he was like, I want to change the industry. What should I do? I have all these interns. I said, these interns are all coming from different backgrounds. I said, send them back. Send them back to where they came from. But give them homework. Every week or 2 weeks, you have to gather them, have a rapid design session, design thinking session, and have them conclude what they've seen is a problem this week, what they think should be the solution this week. Every week, do the same exercise. It doesn't matter what they come up with. It matters that they practice the muscle of seeing opportunity and seeing resources that they could pull together and create a plan. Then you have to train them how to find these resources and make sure that they learn how to recruit people, because you can't change alone. You have to change with your peers. So you could create a force that the top-down force cannot crush you. So this is what I mean by learning how to learn and also treating agility as a muscle. Recently, I had the wonderful, wonderful opportunity to create a workshop to do just this. I was coding my own, software and plans and creating my own change, having my own conclusions, but thankfully, Jane, the leader of this conference, invited me to do this workshop, and that is when I truly realized that more heads is better than one. And to open up myself to them, they in turn gives me so much more back. And it's a lot more than coding. It's a lot more than what we're teaching and learning, but it's more about understanding that you're not doing this alone, and understanding that if people, even though it gets a little complicated because there's more people and more opinion, but in long run, it's better. Because when I'm gone, someone else could help out. And that is the type of change that I want. That's a recap. And I'm sure the slides will be open to download. But it's really simple, but really deep, and really close to human nature. And that's us. That was the first cohort of our workshop. And we did it all together. We talked about technical stuff, but we also talked about business stuff. And I am so proud to be part of this. And thank you very much.